I want to try and give you the gospel from a different angle today. I know usually we show you some pictures of Jesus or video clips where Jesus is being crucified, and we focus a lot on the cross, and the cross is good, and we need to focus on that. But I want to take you to something that happened just before the cross so that we can get a picture of what God has given us. Because I believe sometimes we don't always understand the fullness of what happened, of what took place on that very day. Now I'm going to start off with 1 Corinthians. Sorry, Michelle, I can you rondgooi. Let's get that one on the screen. 1 Corinthians. Say da. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18. There we go. 1 Corinthians 1, 18, Paul writes the following. He says, "The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it is the very power of God." And that is an awesome statement to me. Yes, the message of the cross. If you look at people and you tell people about the cross, sometimes they laugh at you. Sometimes when you live like a Christ-believing follower, people mock you because the message of the cross is foolishness. You see, in this world, power is money. Power is fame. Power is having a gun so you can shoot someone because then you're powerful. You know, power comes from all these outside sources. But the message of the cross is totally different. You see, Jesus didn't rock up on a big flaming white horse with a big flaming sword and fire bolts coming from his eyes and lightning bolts coming from his nostrils. He didn't pitch up like that, although he could, but he didn't pitch up like that to show us how much he loved us. He pitched up a mere human being, a servant of all, to come and to free us, to come and relate with us, to come and be with us. Now I wanna show you something that's just laid on my heart. Vice president wat so baie keer ek gou kan leen. Ek weet julle is heilig oor julle colors, maar ek soek iemand se colors wat sê president. Nou nie jou hele baadjie vir my. Net die helfte. Die belangrike gedeelte. We place a lot of value on this, right? Julle is bikers, doen julle nie. You place a lot of value on it. You know what Jesus did? Picture this jacket as Jesus' divinity, right? Jesus' holiness, Jesus' godliness, right? If you're not into biking and you like fancy suits, or you're a person that likes fancy stuff, picture the most expensive Armani suit jacket that I can be wearing now. And this is Jesus in the fullness of his glory in heaven. And you know what he did with this when he came to earth? He put it on as an apron. He put it on as the lowliest of low forms to say, "I am here. Not as king, not as big shot. I'm here as a servant to you all." And he washed his disciples' feet to teach us a lesson in this humility. Taken everything, laid it aside. All his power, all his strength, he put aside. Now you say, wasn't Jesus God when he walked this earth? Yes, he was, but he was fully human, and he was empowered by the Holy Spirit just like us. So Jesus didn't have any special miracle-working powers while on earth because he gave it away. Then he got filled by the Spirit, and he was empowered to live life like we should be living life. Thanks, Christy. So that's why the message of the gospel is a message of power. And I want to bring you to a place in the gospel, the king and the murderer. And this story, and I don't want to get into all the details of the names and this and that, and people get caught up in all the details of Easter and did it really happen this time, did it this, did it that. I'm not going to even go there. I want to go with you to a simple story that we read. And you find this account in all the Gospels. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, every single one of them, we find this interruption of Jesus on his way to the cross, the whole crucifixion story. We find this single moment, and we don't always read the significance in it. And we're going to read it now in Mark. Michelle, can you give me an upgrade also? Mark 15, and we're going to read from verse 6 to 15. It says, "Now it was the governor's custom each year during the Passover celebration to release one prisoner, anyone the people requested." Verse 7, "One of the prisoners at that time was Barabbas, a revolutionary who had committed murder in an uprising. The crowd went to Pilate and asked him to release a prisoner as usual. 'Would you like me to release to you this king of the Jews?' Pilate asked, for he realized by now that the leading priests had arrested Jesus out of envy." Now remember, Pilate couldn't find any fault in Jesus. He stood before Pilate for trial, and Pilate actually told him, "Listen, I have the power to set you free or to crucify you. That's my choice today." And Jesus spoke with him, and Pilate realized that this man is innocent. There's nothing wrong. He has done no crime. So Pilate goes and finds the worst of criminals, because he thought, maybe, you know, usually I give them someone small, you know, I give them a small fry that just stole something or did something. Now he goes to one of the worst, which is Barabbas. And he places him next to Jesus, and he gives them the option. He says, "Who do you want? Do you want king of the Jews, or do you want Barabbas?" And the crowd cried and cheered for Barabbas. Verse 11 says, "But at this point, the leading priest stirred up the crowd to demand the release of Barabbas instead of Jesus. Pilate asked them, 'Then what should I do with this man that you call the king of the Jews?' And they shouted back, 'Crucify him.' 'Why?' Pilate demanded. 'What crime has he committed?' But the mob roared even louder, 'Crucify him.' So to pacify the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He ordered Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip, then turned him over to the Roman soldiers to be crucified." You all know the rest of the story, what happened. But I want to stand still at this story of Barabbas. Because when you look at it, it's just not right. On the one hand, there's king of the Jews, there's king of the universe, never mind just king of the Jews. And on the other hand, there's thief, there's murderer. The Bible says he was a notorious criminal, which means everybody knew of him. Everybody knew of what he's done. Everybody knew of how bad he really was. And in one of the accounts, they even cry out and say, "It's fine. Jesus' blood is on our hands. It's okay." And that's why even in Acts, you read of this situation. In Acts 3, verse 13 to 14, when Peter preaches to the people, he says, "For it is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of all your ancestors, who has brought glory to his servant Jesus by doing this. This is the same Jesus whom you handed over and rejected before Pilate. Despite Pilate's decision to release him, you rejected this holy, righteous one and instead demanded the release of a murderer." So now I want to draw like just a quick analogy or similarity between this story and us today. You see, when we look at it, if you go into Greek and Hebrew and all of that, you find out that Barabbas had a first name, which is also Jesus. Weird enough. So on the one hand, we have Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, and on the other hand, we have Jesus, Barabbas. Now, if you go into his name, if you split it up, Barabbas, it comes from two words, which is Bar and Abba, which means son of the Father. How strange is that? Jesus, son of the Father, and Jesus, son of the Father. But he was not of the right father. You see, he lived life. And yes, in a way, he was a type of Messiah because he gave the Jewish people what they want. He was a revolutionary. He stood up. He fought. He was one of those people, a zealot. Man, he would take you down if you stand in his way, and he would kill people in the process. And because Jesus didn't become what the people want him to be, because they're waiting for a king to show up, They're waiting for a king to show up in power and in authority and one who will overthrow the Roman rule. So eventually when they get the choice between Jesus, son of the Most High God, and Jesus, son of the Father, Barabbas, they realize that, man, Jesus only did miracles, but he never did what he promised he would do and overthrow the kingdom of Rome. But they never understood the true kingdom Jesus was talking about. So they chose a murderer instead. Because maybe he would do what we are waiting for him to do. You see, we can relate with the two groups of people involved. Today we can relate with the crowd. How many times do we get a choice between Jesus, Son of the Father, and Jesus, who's not really the true Jesus? Come on, I'll say it. Many of us serve a plastic Jesus. Many of us serve Jesus as if he's not truly real, as if he's just a patch that we put on. Many of us serve Jesus as if he's just another fairy tale. You know, I don't really know if this thing is real, but oh well. See, and people like that end up on a dead-end street because the real Jesus brings life. The real Jesus brings peace. The real Jesus brings comfort. The real Jesus brings freedom. But you'll never know it unless you seek him and know him truly. You'll never know him as the Prince of Peace unless you seek peace from him. But most of us seek peace from the other Jesus, the plastic Jesus, the one who can just rock up and snap his fingers and everything is changed. Because we pray to the plastic Jesus for instant answers and it doesn't come, then we go our way and do something else and seek our peace, seek our joy elsewhere. See, we can relate with the crowd because every day we get a choice. Every day it's like Pilate stands before us and says, who do you want? Do you want Jesus? The real Jesus? The one who can really save you and help you? The one who can really be with you? But it's a choice. And it's not just the choice that is spoken with lips. It begins with lips and you say and confess that he's your Savior. But it's a choice that changes every bit of who you are. That's why many times, and people get upset with me when I say it, but I say, if you're not changed, once you've met Jesus, if there's nothing that changes in your life and you don't become a better person and you stand here today and you look back over your life in the last year, we won't even go back 6 years, just in the last couple of months, if there is no change in your life, question your salvation and which Jesus you truly serve. Because if there is no change, you're serving the wrong Jesus. Because the true King of Kings brings change. The true King of Kings brings transformation. The true King of Kings says, if you love me, you will obey my commands. We can't just live and do as we please and think Jesus is okay with it. Because that's plastic Jesus. He's okay with it, but he'll get you into hell one day. We need to start serving Jesus. Son of the Most High God, Son of the True Father, not Son of the Devil. But the other point that I want to bring across is we can relate with Barabbas. You see, here's this story, right? Of this criminal, of this murderer standing. And you know, he thinks, yeah, it's all on me, man. People love me. But it wasn't the people that set him free. It was the love of the guy right next to him that set him free. It was the fact that the one standing, the one righteous one, the innocent one, the perfect one, chose and said, I love you so much that I'm okay if the people choose you. You see, and what saddens me the most is Barabbas doesn't even know Jesus. He doesn't even know who this man is next to him, and he doesn't even really care. He just goes, yeah, I'm free, and he walks away. Does he even recognize what's been given to him? Does he even recognize what's this gift that has just taken place? He was on death row on his way to be punished by death, crucifixion, pain. And crucifixion is the most horrific way of dying in history. There was no way that was more horrible than to die on that cross. If you do your research, it's nothing like the movies. They give us an idea, but it's just a drop in the bucket of what it truly is. Because according to the Word of God, Jesus was beaten beyond human recognition. You couldn't even recognize him anymore. And he did it for you and me. He did it for Barabbas. You see, Barabbas walks away and we think, ah, thief, murderer. And God goes, no, I love him. But God, he didn't do anything to deserve your love. No, I love him. I love him. And I choose this because I love him. And all of us stand in the place of Barabbas. The day that Jesus chose to die, all of us stood there next to him. If you're still a sinner and you haven't come to Christ, you're standing in that place. Maybe you are saved, but you've turned away from God, then you're standing in that place today. Come on, we spoke about it last week. The week before. We're all lying, thieving, adulterers. You know, we'd say we don't commit murder. We can't be Barabbas. Jesus said, if you think hatefully towards your brother, you have committed murder. So in that case, we're all murderers as well. See, we stand today at this place when we draw our attention back to the cross, when we draw our attention back to what Jesus did, we stand at the place where it's the king and the murderer. And you stand here and you're chained and you're bound by your sin. And you wonder, how can I ever get free? What can I ever do to unlock these chains? How can I work my way out? Jy gee my bietjie olie dat ek my hande hier kan draai uitwurm. And Jesus sê, nee. You can't do it. Only I can. God, I want to save my marriage. No, you can't. I want to stop the sin in my life. No, you can't. Not in your own strength. You will fail every single time, single-handedly. That is why the message of the cross is a message of power. That is why the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but a matter of power. Why? Because we cannot free ourselves. We cannot set ourselves free. Only the king can. So I go on in my sin until I stop. No. You lay it at his feet. You cry your heart out until the freedom comes. You want to save your marriage? Start it on your knees. You want to save your life? Start on your knees. You want to get free from addiction? Start on your knees. Cry out your heart until you can't cry no more before Jesus and say, I can't do this, God. I need you. And the Savior will say, it's okay, Barabbas. I love you. You can go. I will break the chains for you. But the saddest thing in our lives is sometimes Jesus breaks the chains today, and you're just back to Barabbas tomorrow. Sometimes Jesus breaks the bondages and the curses off your life. The blood of Jesus cleanses you and washes you clean. And you're back to Barabbas the next day. Because we don't walk in the freedom that Christ gives us. We don't make that choice to say, God, you've given me the freedom. Now I will step up in the freedom. You've set me free from this addiction. I will throw away everything that keeps me bonded and I will live it. Come on, it's so sad to me. People slowly fade out of their addiction. Use tablets and stuff to get them off of it, and that's okay, but then that tablet becomes your next drug. Think of it. If Jesus sets you free, I've seen many people that throws away everything, flushes it down the toilet, and they're free. Does it mean there's never cravings? No, there will be cravings. Does it mean there's no cold turkey and all of that? No, there will be that. But there will be the power of Christ to carry you through because you made a choice. Come on, the Bible says some people are like dogs that go back to their own vomit. And it's the same with us. That's why we really need to understand the power of what happens in that moment when we choose Jesus, when we choose the right one, when we choose the real one. Every single chain drops off, and Jesus says, I love you that much. Oh, but God, I need to work my way to you. No, no. Rest in my love. But God, I need to do things now. I need to. No, no. Get to know me. Have intimacy with me. Have quality time with me. And people don't understand it. But Christianity is not works. We are not saved by our works. We are saved for good works. But where do the good works come from? From intimacy with Jesus. You can't become a better man or a better woman if you're not close to Jesus. You can't become a better husband or a better wife if you're not close to Jesus. You can't become a better child for your parents if you're not close to Jesus. You can't get rid of your sin if you're not close to Jesus. The Bible calls him the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the one true living God. There is no one like him. There is no one beside him. There is no one that can match him. There is no prescription pill that can match the power of Jesus. There is no drug that can match the power of Jesus. There is no sin that can bring you the satisfaction that Jesus can. There is no nothing that can give you what Jesus can. No amount of money, no amount of wealth, no amount of completion and success in your life, no amount of cars and bikes and houses and stuff can make you a fulfilled man or woman. No husband, no wife, no outside of marriage thing that you've got going, no mistress, no adultery thing going, no pornography, no lesbianism or homosexuality, no nothing can give you what Jesus can. Because all of this that I just mentioned will satisfy you for a moment. But you know what else comes with that satisfaction? Destruction from the inside out. Because if we remain in the chains like Barabbas and we don't drop them off with the freedom of Christ and walk away, the chains start killing us. The Bible says it, for the wages of sin is death. Maybe not physical death. Some sin will lead to physical death. But the wages of sin is death. That's why last week when I spoke about that emotional connection with God, that feeling close to God, if you don't feel that, you need to do some introspection. Because maybe there's something in your life that wedges in between you and God and keeps you apart from one another. That's why we need to come back to the cross today. That's why today we need to realize that maybe I am still Barabbas. Maybe I am still son of the father, the devil. But I want to become son of the Holy One. Son of the God who made me. Daughter of the King. And that happens when we make a choice. You see, when Jesus hung on that cross, the chains were already broken. It's us that keep them on us. See, when Jesus died on that cross, the prison doors swung open. It's us that choose to stay inside. Because sometimes it's comfortable in our sin. Sometimes it's comfortable in our wrong mindsets and our bad attitudes. Sometimes it's even comfortable in our pain and in our misery. Why? Because we know it so long, we don't really want out of it because I get attention. But those things will bring death. You see, if we walk away from Jesus in our life and in the choices we make, it's like being on a highway. Jy Kroonstad toe ry, dan kry jy bordjies. They say 100 kilometers, 50 kilometers, 30 kilometers, and then you're there. So you don't just end up there. It's a process. And it's the same when you turn away from Jesus and you walk the other way. You'll see signposts because God loves you so much that He doesn't want you to go that way. And He'll put up posts saying 100 kilometers till you reach death, 80 kilometers till you reach death, 50 kilometers till you reach death. But the problem is the Holy Spirit's voice gets all softer. So those last couple of signs, 20 kilometers, 10 kilometers and that, you're not going to see them so well if you don't wake up when you see the first couple of signs. Because our hearts become calloused toward the Holy Spirit. And hopefully today, when you truly understand the power of the cross, when you truly understand that moment when Jesus hung on that cross, they said it a minute ago, it wasn't the nails that held him there. Jesus could call 12 legions of angels in that moment. 12 legions. This is Frackbuyer. He could call 12 legions of angels to pitch up and to destroy everyone and say, I've had enough. Come on, think about it. That moment when he knelt in the garden and his sweat became like great drops of blood. Can you imagine what kind of stress and anxiety do you need to be under for your sweat to become drops of blood? It can actually happen scientifically. But can you imagine what intense moment that should be? We don't always see it. We don't always realize it. But I mean, here is Jesus, human like you and I, knowing that I have lived 33 years on this earth just so I have to die. We get upset when we don't get things our way. He came here knowing that His purpose is to pay the ultimate price. And we don't want to pay a small sacrifice every day by getting on our knees and praying to Him. And He knelt in that garden filled with this anxiety and stress, and He said, Father, if it's at all possible, if there's any way, please let this cup pass from me. But then He makes this choice and He says, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Jacket, lay down. Not my will, but your will be done, O God. Come on, think about it. How many times in life do we do things our way? How many times in life do we do as we please, what we want, how we please it, and we hurt so many people in the process? And here's Jesus, King of Kings, Creator of heaven and earth, on His knees. The power to call 12 legions of angels, but His prayer is not my will, but your will be done, O God. See, the Bible says he did it for the joy set before him. You know what was the joy set before him? That you, Barabbas, could be free. That you could live life in the freedom that his grace brings. That you could have relationship with him. He did all of that to invite you and to stretch out his hand and say, come, walk with me. And that was his heart from the very beginning when he created Adam and Eve. He didn't tell them, do this spiritual warfare and do this prayer and do this and do that and do the other. He said, walk with me in the cool of the day. Walk with me. Be intimate with me. Spend time with me. Come on, it's so sad that Jesus longs so much for intimacy. But all we give him in return is religion. Prayers because we have to. Time because we're forced to. Some of us don't even give him that. You see, Barabbas walked away that day, not knowing what he received, not knowing what was given to him. All of us stand here this day, and hopefully you can see now what was given. Hopefully you can begin to understand. We'll never truly understand the fullness of God's grace and what happened that day. But don't be a Barabbas that just walks away. Man, turn to Jesus and say, God, you've given me my life. And in return, I'll give it back to you. Because I wouldn't have had it in any way. I would have been dead. All of us would be condemned to hell if Jesus didn't stretch out his arms. Because you can't be a good person on your own. No matter how good you are compared to the next guy, compared to God's standards, you'll never make it. On your way to eternal flames and fire. And Jesus said, I don't want that because hell was never made for you. It was made for the devil and his rebelling angels. Sadly enough, many of us, when the chains drop off, we walk away. Don't just walk away today. Realize what he's given you. Realize the price that has been paid. And turn to him today and say, God, because you've given me everything, I'll give you everything in return. But John, I'm broken. It's okay. I messed up. It's okay. I've got sin in my life. It's fine. I'm addicted. It's okay. Turn to Jesus. He says, come as you are. Come as you are. Because Barabbas, no matter what your yesterday was, no matter what your today is, I can give you a better tomorrow. Not because of what you do, but because of what I've done. And because of what you can bring to the table, but what I've already brought. We are the righteousness of God through the power of Jesus Christ. And when you make that choice today to turn back to him, make it a point in your life to become intimate with him. Pray every day. Read your Bible. Come on, families. Get back to the place where you have house worship. Father of the house, God calls you to be the priest, which means your whole family's spiritual maturity rests on your shoulders. And if they don't grow, you are going to stand accountable before God one day. And mom of the house, if dad's not doing it, step up to the plate and do it. Because maybe then he'll wake up. But don't neglect God. Don't make him a pastime activity in your life. Don't put him on the bench anymore. Don't be like Barabbas and just walk away. Realize what has been given and turn to Jesus and say, God, you have my everything. So with that said, Sean's left me. Net begin, Joel. I'm going to pray and then we're going to start worshiping. And as we worship, the communion tables are in front. So we're not going to hand them out today. I want it to be different like we did it last year. So I want the men of the house to be priests today. And I want you to take your wife, your children. I want you to come forward. And I want you to serve your family communion today. And I want you to be bold. Maybe you're not here as husband and wife, then president of a bike club. Serve your club members today. Maybe dad's not here, then mom, you can do it. Serve your family. If you're alone, it's also fine, then come forward. Maybe bring someone with and serve someone. And as we worship, it's your time. So while you're in the bench, please don't just sit there. Pray and be with us in the Spirit. And seek God's face. And when you are ready, come forward. And make the choice to not be like Barabbas and walk away, but make the choice today to turn to Jesus. Whether it's for the first time in your life, whether it's for the second, the third, or the tenth, or the hundredth time, it's fine. Just turn to Him today and give Him a brand new chance. And say, God, I might not be who you want me to be, but I'm willing to become that person. If you will help me, I give everything to you. So in your own time, as an act of worship, come and serve one another. And I want you to be bold. For those of you wearing your waistcoats, I want you to leave your waistcoat at your seat. Because your identity is not in this. Your identity is not in the scroll that says president. Your identity is in Jesus. So lay down that thing today. Say, Jesus, I don't care about any patch. I don't care about any club affiliation. I don't care about anything today but you. And I'm willing to lay everything down. Do it as a physical act of prophetic word or a prophetic action today. And those that are not wearing it, lay something down. Say, God, I give it to you. I lay down my life. I lay down who I used to become who you want me to be. So God, we pray that in this moment you will come and meet with us. In this moment you will come and have a moment with us, Holy Spirit. That you'll reach into our hearts and let this word ring to the deepest corners of who we are. So that we will realize the deepness and the truthfulness and the price that Jesus paid for us. And God, as we realize the true power of the cross, may it come into our lives and set us free. We turn back to you, God. We don't want to be Barabbas anymore. We don't want to walk away anymore. We want to walk to you, God. Give us the strength. Give us the grace so that we can live lives that honor you. Every single day, draw us back to you, God. Draw us closer to you so that we don't live far away, but that we live right next to you every single moment of the day so that we can become who you called us to be. Help us, God, to lay down the addictions today. Help us to lay down the sin. Help us to lay down the mess that we find ourselves in and to give it all to you, because at the cross, everything is made new. And help us today, God, if we have that moment at the table of the Lord, to experience that freedom that you give us. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.